couple of generations back, people believed that women were not capable of intellectual activity and sophistication. Even today, a lot of men would tell you women are not intelligent, it's not part of their makeup. And, you know, girls were in our country were not given equal rights of education. But in several classes now, middle classes in cities, girls are getting chances to study. Still not equal chances. But every single time the end of the school exam results come out, the headline is always the same, which is girls ahead of boys one more time, something like that. So what happened to that belief that girls are not capable of intellectual performance? Was that a biological difference? Or was it a socially constructed difference? So gender, please understand, gender is not about biological differences. Gender is about social and cultural construction of biological differences. So if women and men, boys and girls, have exactly the same life chances, you would actually in society have slightly more women than men, or slightly more girls than men. Now, let us assume that they would be exactly equal. And in most countries, you do find that situation. But in India, in South Asia, you're finding a situation which is a really dramatic situation. It's a situation that you actually have far fewer girls and women per every 1,000 than men and girls. But what is even more striking is that these numbers are actually going further and further down. So as we are modernizing, as we are having economic growth, as we are getting all our freedoms and so on, we not only have an adverse sex ratio, we also have a declining sex ratio. So from the time when these censuses started happening scientifically from the year 1900, what we are finding is actually that the number of girls to boys in 1900, the ratio was better than it is in the year 2010. So you're seeing this situation. I mean, you have a sex ratio of 972 in 1901. It's come down to 943, slightly higher than 933. So for every 1,000 boys today, there are 943 girls. A phenomenon which is called missing women. And Earth Sen has calculated that there are about 35 in India today, there are 35 million missing women. Missing. Now, if you believe that this is largely a problem of poor, illiterate, low caste, rural people, you'd be amazed. The worst sex ratios of all are in South Delhi. The places which have, it's Haryana, Delhi, Chandigarh, which actually have the worst sex ratios in the country. And within Delhi, it is South Delhi, which is the most prosperous, the most educated, the most westernized. Sex selective abortions and neglect of baby girls is one part of the story, but it's not the full story. It is really about lifelong discrimination and denial of healthcare, good nutrition and life opportunities to girls within the household. It is intra-family inequalities that we take for granted. And you need to recognize them even within our own household environment. A girl is brought up to believe that she doesn't deserve to have what is best. Everybody else needs to have it first.
I mean, my own mother, I, as a child, I used to notice that when chicken is chicken was served, the worst part of the chicken is the neck. Chicken neck, no towards the teeth. So I used to find she always served herself the chicken neck. And it would irritate me a lot. I would say, why don't you take a proper piece that really helps? She said, no, I love eating the chicken neck. So I said, okay, but when I see you, when you go out for a wedding or to a party or something, I never see you taking the chicken neck, I see you eating all everything else. So what happens then? But she just felt, she brought up to believe that she doesn't deserve to eat. A good woman will make sure that everybody else eats and she doesn't cook. It's something that is culturally ingrained, that a girl or a woman doesn't deserve. I've gone to a lot of natural disasters. We've gone to a place called Latur, which had an earthquake, where a lot of people died, because the houses suddenly collapsed and people were badly injured and so on. So obviously when the initial deaths happened, the numbers of girls and women were almost proportional to the number of men and boys who died. But in the first 10 days after, far more girls and women died than boys and men. Why do you think that happened? I was there, I actually saw this happening, and then I saw the data. Why do you think that after the disaster, girls and women died in much greater numbers than boys and men? Pardon?
Rescued first.
There's minimum healthcare available. Who's taken there first? Where is their greater urgency? In fact, I got into Rampur, I was volunteering there with a group of young doctors. And at some point we started fighting with people because we found that it was largely men who were being brought to the center. People, that sense of urgency that this life is valuable, as valuable, is not there. And it's culturally there across the earth. Culture, it seems to be much stronger, as evidenced in this whole unique phenomenon, South Asian phenomenon of misery. It's unique to this part of the world. One other thing I forgot to say, that men also tend to lead culturally more violent lives. They go to war, they go into brawls, etc. So their numbers should be even less. So it is in food, work, education, healthcare, opportunity, participation, development, keeps women, within society, but within the household as well. And you must recognize that this is the most intimate form of discrimination. It's intimate because it is by people you love the most. It is in the intimate spaces within a home that girls and women face denials, which we cannot refuse to accept because the evidence is that they are not surviving. Am I making sense? So, are you recognizing the enormity of this fact? What happens in our social understanding? This is now not just specific to South Asia but all over the world. Women, by and large, are not treated as ends in themselves. They are not important for themselves. They are important for what they can. They are instruments as reproducers, as caregivers, as sexual outlets. A family's prosperity is embodied in her. So she's useful. A man is useful for himself. A woman is useful for what she can provide the man. There's a cultural construction to this in this way. And traditionally in the Manusmriti, which we saw then also yesterday, the female is seen as complement to the male, but always one has to be subordinate to him. So Manu says that a woman has to be under the control of her father in her childhood, of her husband in her adulthood, and of her son in old age. She always has to be subordinate. But we see this also in other cultures. And then you have this very special situation of female genital shows. Let me just say, earlier in this, in the Indian context again, leaving students here, who is the goddess of wealth? Who is the goddess of learning?
Saraswati.
Who is the goddess of power, Shakti? It's extraordinary that women are goddesses of wealth, of learning, and of power, and they denied wealth, learning, and power so profoundly. Something to think about. So you place women on a pedestal and then deny them precisely what you have glorified them as. But the women who cause us the greatest anxiety as men are women who don't have men in their life. Single women. Culturally, all over the world, particularly for some reason, in India, single women create great anxieties in a patriarchal society. Single women are women who are widowed, abandoned, never married, or women who choose to leave their husband's home because of violence. They cause a strange kind of anxiety among men, because we somehow see a woman, a male who doesn't have a female partner has no problem. But a female who doesn't have a male partner is looked upon with anxiety of various kinds in a patriarchal society. Is that right? And therefore, the way that we have culturally treated our widows is particularly shameful and worrying. Somehow, once a woman loses her male partner at any age, culturally, she's supposed to desexualize herself. She wears white, her hair is cut. She should, and she's made to wake up early in the morning, do a lot of physical work. Somehow, her femininity and her sexuality is a threat to the rest of the world. And I see this across cultures, working again the survivors, the survivors of violence here. Some of the worst treatment has been for women who were widowed in the violence. And getting their stories, you see, and this is Muslim communal organizations. The government did nothing for relief in their application, so you had organizations like Jamaat Islami, etc., come and set up these relief colonies. Now, in these relief colonies, if you are a single woman who lost your husband, you lost your sons, etc., in the violence, and then you're given these, they treat them with so much derision. And the women tell us there's no way they can fill their stomach, so they go out to work. When they go out to work, they say you are engaging in sex work, prostitutes, etc. So then they say, you tell us if you don't go out to work, how are we going to feed ourselves? They said Islam has no prohibition on widows getting remarried. So one of the women was telling me, so then when Maulvi told her this, so she said, who's going to marry me? Why don't you marry me? And he got very sort of startled. But they continue to shame them and humiliate them because they are single women. Rather than being sympathetic that she's lost her husband in the violence. The number of single women headed households in India has grown from as high as 9% to 14%. When we talk about the growing face, the female face of poverty this is a trend that we find. Female-headed households, female who heads a household tends to be older than men, have less education, overrepresented in the lower quartiles, poorer basically, and with fewer assets.